जब सृष्टि पर प्रलय आती है उस समय भगवान प्रलय के अंत में संस्कृति, धर्म और विज्ञान के बीजों की रक्षा के लिए मत्स्य का रूप धारण करके महाप्रलय के जल से उनकी रक्षा करते हैं।
Lakhs of devotees are participating in the Kumbh Mela every day despite the massive surge in cases. Basic COVID protocols were also given a miss amid the religious gap. 816 antiviral injections have been stolen from the hospital.
ये भगवान की ही कृपा है जिसके कारण दुनिया इतनी बड़ी हिल गई, हम बच गए।
As far as our fight against COVID-19 is concerned, that India is going to stand apart from the rest of the world.
ये जिंदगी जागो।
There was an upsurge in the COVID cases now over here in this market area. This is an extremely crowded area.
तरह में तनिक सोचिए वासुदेव, तनिक सोचिए, तनिक मेरी पीड़ा समझने का प्रयत्न कीजिए और इसका उपचार बताइए। हे देवकी नंदन,
वेलकम गाइस टू द थर्ड एपिसोड ऑफ कॉन आर्टिस्ट। So today we have with us Mrs. Kavita Kane, and like she is one of the eminent writers in Indian mythology. She has written books like Karna's Wife, which is like the best seller in this genre, and other books. तो मतलब ऐसा काफ़ी काफ़ी सही है, और हमें आज इंडियन मैथोलॉजी पर बात करनी थी और वो कैसे लिटरेचर का एक जो माइंडली इसको पुट करें कि वो इसका पार्ट है लिटरेचर का, तो हाउ इट वर्क्स एंड वट कुड वी लर्न फ्रॉम इट। तो हमें लगा इनसे बढ़िया तो कौन ही हो सकता है, मतलब ऐसा है ना। शी इज़ ऑल्सो कमिंग अप विद हर न्यू बुक, जो कि ऐसे लास्ट में बताएंगे उसकी इन्फॉर्मेशन, क्योंकि एंटिसिपेशन है कि नहीं। तो चालू कर लेते हैं। वेलकम मैम, हाउ आर यू?
गुड,
रियली हेलो।
यस मैम। सो मैम, बिफोर डाइविंग डीप, फर्स्ट आई वॉन्ट टू नो लाइक वाई शुड वी रीड दिस पर्टिकुलर आर्ट, आर्ट ऑफ पीस एज इन लिटरेचर, दिस इंडियन माइथोलॉजी सेगमेंट, एंड हाउ यू ट्रांजिशन फ्रॉम यू नो बीइंग असिस्टेंट एडिटर to a writer in Indian mythology? Like, what intrigued you the most about it?
The first time I sort of was introduced to mythology, let's say, was, of course, I think everyone's, that's how they are introduced, was through Amar Chitrakatha. I mean, we used to love, I mean, our school, we were not allowed to read comics at all. So whether it's Archie, but I think Amar Chitrakatha actually gave us the first introduction to our epics, Purans, and our history also, actually, a lot of stories from there. And mythology, why I was intrigued by mythology was when I was a literature student, I realized mythology was a huge subject there. I came to know mythology as a subject where it is actually a literary tool, where it becomes a platform to not just portray the writer's ideas and his thoughts, but also it's a medium through which he actually uses as a literary tool for everything, not only for his thoughts, but as a dramatic expression. He uses, metaphors, be it allegories, so it becomes an active platform. It becomes an active creative platform. And I think if you see whether it's Milton, you see most of the poets and especially the poets actually used mythology, different mythologies of Europe to sort of as an extended metaphor in the books. because I think it's an extremely liberal, creative platform, in a sort of a canvas where a writer is able to portray all his whatever he has to say. It's literally like a canvas, you know. He sort of adds the cues. And because I think it's a definition where I think people sort of dismiss mythology as, you know, ancient stories. But I think what is most important about mythology is this art of storytelling, if you actually see, which is the basis of literature. So, if you actually see the way the narrative is there of the epics, it's almost like a continuous web. It's sort of a web of short stories, you know, one story, story linked to the other. So, there are a lot of short stories, and each short that is the art of storytelling, because each story they are telling you something, and that continues throughout, you know, throughout the narrative. And you can imagine something as huge as the Mahabharata. I mean, you can imagine how many stories it must be. They are told, they need to be told, retold, or whatever. And that's, I think that is basically the magic of mythology here. It is basically in a very simple distilled form, it is storytelling. Earlier it was, of course, oral storytelling, but then, of course, it started getting written down, and you know, that's how from oral it started getting written. And then later on, I think right from the time of Kalidas and all, they all used the epics as what is Shakuntala. Shakuntala is a story he picked up from Mahabharata. So I think they have always been used, and even modern writers, contemporary writers have always been doing that. And I think it is an extremely powerful medium.
So I'm moving to the writing bit part.
People often, you know, when I read, like, they often label a writer to a particular, you know, that he writes or she writes about women-centric books. So, like, labeling a particular character just based on his sex, like, is it justifiable?
Honestly, women writing as a complete narrative, as a form, is important because women writing about women is a huge thing. It is a huge thing. It's a very necessary thing. Because women have been the marginalized community for a very, very long time. It still are. So, I don't think the men are really. There are a few men who are writing, interested in talking about women and their issue. But it's only the women who are going to write about their issue. So, I think it becomes a very strong, because if you see what happened 100 years ago, I mean, how many women were allowed to write? I mean, this whole thing of... and when they are writing their issues, their problems, there are... women-centric stories which can be best told by women, possibly because most of them, it is also where the woman writer is she's a product of the society.
So, basically, baat aisi hai ki if I am a woman aur mujhe women ke bare mein likhna hai, toh I would write more freely or more in-depth. You know, I could see that perspective from my eyes, or फिर मैं उसको ऐसे लपेट के, मतलब कुछ तो एकदम ऐसे अच्छी तरीके से ऐसे ऐसे पैकेज वैकेज करके रख के मेरे परस्पेक्टिव से ऐसे मैं बांट सकती हूँ, तो वो ज़्यादा ऐसे पढ़ने में एकदम ऐसे झकास लगेगा रेदर देन मतलब एकदम ऐसे ही किसी और ने लिख दिया टाइप. तो
सो आई थिंक यस इट इज अ वेरी पावरफुल वुमन राइटिंग इज इट इज वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट आई मीन यू कांट इट्स अ मूवमेंट इट्स ऑलमोस्ट अ मूवमेंट एंड it just goes beyond gender and socio-political situations as such.
So, ma'am, the next bit I want to ask you is about, you know, we see that there are like more than 2,500 characters in Mahabharata. So, often writers, like artists, they take inspiration from them, or sometimes they blatantly copy the whole story, the whole narrative.
Yeah, okay. Now, when we're talking about this, as I told you earlier, mythology has always been, literature and mythology has always been interrelated. They're very, very, extremely strong relationship. And through that, I mean, when you're talking about the different versions and the different stories of, especially the different versions of the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, what it actually shows are different perspectives. These stories are universal, you know, if you're talking about, if not about as I said, stories about gods and goddesses, stories about the humans, it's about mortality, it's about the humankind. These stories have, again, not only just a moral basis, they have a very strong philosophical and psychological moorings as such. So, I think, and which are very relevant today. So, this, when an author picks up this story, he tries to, he's just not retelling a story, he's revisiting those stories, he's revisioning those stories. So, and he's adding a little bit. So, when I'm writing, example, let me talk about my own self, I'll not talk about any other author. And when I'm writing my story, obviously it's fiction. It's not, and especially it's in their marginalized characters. The thing is, since it is fiction, I am going to add a little bit. Now, the thing is, now you are asking is how morally correct is it that. But yes, when I am writing, I realize they are not my character, that they are borrowed character. I definitely have that in mind. Secondly, I know that I have to write in a certain manner and way where it becomes a part of the collective imagination, because I cannot write about any of my characters which is completely different what the readers already have in mind. You know? So it's not like I'm trying to. So whether I use an alternative perspective, a suburban perspective, or a gender perspective for this, the thing is, I cannot change that particular part about the character not being mine. I have to keep it definitely in mind. The story is not mine. But yes, the interpretation can be mine. So, while interpreting characters and events and the episodes, yes, I think a writer has, definitely has. It's not plagiarism. Plagiarism would be actually copying line by line. Yeah. And, no, but I think, that's why I said mythology and literature have always, you cannot say that they're lifting stories. No, they're not lifting. It is. That is why they are there. Why do you think these stories are there for so many centuries down? Why are they still there? Popular, and both with the readers and the writers, you know. So it's sort of an ongoing relationship, and it's going to be there for another thousand of years. So, because I think it's always been, every version of the epics was a statement that yes, the writers are seeing it through a fresh eyes, fresh look, a certain perspective. It could be so personal, social, political, you know, a gender perspective. Right? I think the stories have been told.
Kern, the character Kern in Mahabharat. So like he's like often covered, like people relate to it, and they are, he's seen and covered under this blanket of sympathy and doom. Like he also reprimanded Kunti when before going to the war, and people say ki hame bhi itna nahi mila, matlab hame bhi ta talent tha, and still, you know, we are not that like dunya mein jaanti nahi hai, kind of, they portray kind of that. So we see a little bit a glimpse of self-pity. So like why do you think people relate to that character so much, and what are the takeaways, like can we learn from that?
I think when I wrote Karna's wife, it was not definitely not a glorification of Karna at all.
Yes.
Because I think he's already a glorified character, very much. Mm-hmm. I think he's the classic tragic hero. He's an anti-hero actually. And I wanted to show him as an anti-hero in the sense, you know, it's like we sort of slot, we either love Karna or you hate Karna. Yeah. I actually was interested in the gray shades, because, and I think that holds true of each and every character in the Mahabharata. There is no one who is white and black at all, if you actually see in certain situation, in certain circumstances, as per the vis-a-vis a different person, they change, that is the time they show their goodness, their meanness, their foolishness. So with all the human fallacies, I think you see, and I think Karna is the biggest example of that, because while torn between this whole moral dilemma he has, and of course his personal angst of being a pariah, of never being socially accepted, I think between these two moral dilemmas is this character who, you see, going from getting darker and darker through the narrative, you know, how he becomes a dark character. So I think that I think could be only seen by his wife. So I created this fictitious character. I took that liberty and I created that fictitious character essentially to show in his whole this abyss that he was in darkness. Because we always see, he's sort of a noble
man and doing.
Noble man in a crisis, having his. So I think yes, he is that. But you know, there is a point where he has to. It was his choice. He has a. It is a choice where he has to cross the line and decide on which how he wants to be known as. You know, to be known as a, technically, let's talk about the stereotypes of a good man or a bad man. So I think he goes beyond that, and I think his personal dilemma becomes a private dilemma. It is not. I think so. That is why I think he's more of a tortured man, because it remains a personal. He has no one to talk to in the sense, or over. He has no counselor. He has no one to advise, and I think he's not a person who would even listen to advice. You know, after a point of time, so. He is a man, he's sort of a paradox. He's loyal, he has all the qualities, but there is darkness in him. So I think it goes beyond self-pity. After a point, it becomes almost a self-destructive streak, you know, where he's pushing himself into the darkness. So I think Karna, that is why he's one of the most complex characters. So I don't think bracketing him as just a noble warrior and into a dark fiend, I think that's very fair. I think what they're trying to say is that through Karna, I think you realize that we should not commit the mistake which he made. Or if he is a product of social injustice, how after a point you have to overcome that, you know, in the sense you evolve as a person because of the social injustices. So I think Karna is a classic example of that, where torn between his personal angst and his personal strife and the socio-political strife he sort of gets involved in. And then in the end, the battlefield, the Kurukshetra, becomes both his internal and external battle, where he is defeated. He is defeated completely, destroyed.
So, my next bit is like, I want to ask you about this our generation have created that in my thought, it is justifiable to drink, to have fun, to have leisure, a sort of. We take, what do you say, freedom in saying that. Ki, matlab, us zamane mein hota tha, toh why we should stop now? Like, if they would have done it, and of course, Indian mytho is related to religion, so we usko usse bhi jod dete hain ki, you know, religious hai toh, why should we stop that? So, like, where should we, held ourselves? Like, कहाँ पे हमको एकदम लाइन खींचनी चाहिए कि no, 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 this is wrong. Like, we cannot take the freedom to, connect Indian mytho with that.
No, I think that is exactly. I think we underestimate a reader. I think a reader does realize that. I think these epics it goes beyond religion. It goes, and as I told you, it has very strong, philosophical layering. I think if you have to realize that they are not just literal stories. They have very, very strong, they are all metaphors, most of them are metaphors. They have a very deep, not only meaning, they have, and the meaning is also not very, very obvious. The more you read it, the more, it is complex, it is complicated, and it is layered. So the reader is supposed to sort of peel off each layer and try to understand the story. And basically what they are trying to say is, telling the readers is to think, you know, these stories are made, not only to it's not enjoying for the moment, but yes, it is. These are stories which makes you think. You are not supposed to judge. I mean, the whole important part was you not being myopic and with your personal biases and prejudices, and see the story for what it is. And it is supposed to enlighten you. You know, so this whole thing of validating your action through these characters. No, in fact, you are about, if they have, as I said just before, if you think Karna is a hero or if he is a villain, whatever it is, I think learn from his mistakes and try to see how much it is sort of reflecting in your own life. So it is not that they are not role, they are role models, but it depends on how you are going to take that role model. So I think the basic thing about, especially the women characters, is that given the situation, they were extremely. They were fighters. They were basically survivors. They were fighters. I think this is what is important. What has to be taken in the story. there are no happy ending. Most of them don't have a happy ending. It's not a question of winning or losing. Here is a question of this whole will to live and to live with dignity and grace and to fight back. If there are crises, of course there are crises. There are a series of crises which each of them have. And how they fight it out. So I think these episodes, these stories, these anecdotes are supposed to be eye-openers to us. So, as I said, please don't restrict it to religious context. It definitely beyond that. It is they have a larger meaning, a deeper meaning.
So basically, what I'm trying to say is ki mai to hai na, but padhne ki bahut zarurat hai aur complex hai. तो ऐसा नहीं कि रिलीजन से जोड़ दो कि ऐसा नमन करके आगे बढ़ जाओ और बहुत सारी फिलोसफिकल बातें जो आपकी समझ सकते हो जो कि आप ज़िंदगी में इम्बाइब कर सकते हो और आपको हेल्प कर सकती हो एज एन इंडिविजुअल रहने के लिए यही मतलब है ना.
दीज रिफ्लेक्शंस आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट वेरी वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट.
सो मूविंग ऑन टू आवर नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन. सो व्हाट्स योर क्रिएटिव प्रोसेस एज अ राइटर एंड लाइक इन दिस होल पेंडेमिक सिचुएशन एंड व्हाट आर योर टिप्स फॉर एनी यंग एस्पायरिंग राइटर्स.
I'll divide the question into two. First is my how I handled. I continued with my writing. I think my new book would be out in July, mid-July. It's on Saraswati. I think one of the most. She's also one of the most. She's just not a goddess. She's a concept. You know, we're talking about knowledge and wisdom. And how relevant is knowledge and wisdom in today's world? So I think it's. I think it was a very difficult book. I started off it, and I hope you all like it. And it should be out this July. And so that kept me busy. I am writing on the next one, and yes, so I'm keeping my 5 hours of writing. That is my thread of sanity. And tips for the budding writers is, I think first, I think they should read a lot. I think reading is very important. I'm not talking about only English. I mean, you read your vernacular literature, your own, the literature of your mother tongue. I mean, because it shows the literature of your mother tongue actually shows you as an individual, as a person of that society which you are living in. You know, because that is the beauty of your own mother tongue. So I think we should explore, we explore your own literature. And when you're talking about, if you're going to write in English, whatever it is, just read a lot. I mean, because reading and literature is just not about, it's just not a hobby, it is just not an interest. It is, it opens a different world. It is, the importance of literature is like, they say literature is a reflection of society. So, not only that, they show you a different world. I think it makes you think, as I said, it opens your mind to a different world. You know, we are talking about reflection, and we are talking about the influence of, and all this. You know, there is a certain growth a reader feels. There is a conceptual growth, especially a conceptual growth, where we are not just talking about vivid settings and dramatic events and fantastic characters. We are, you know, it's a different world we are living in, but it also opens your mind. It gives you the power to think, to come up to, you have your opinions, you find. So I think reading evolves you as a, sort of matures you as a person. So I think reading is important, very important. Secondly, writing, when you are writing, this whole hesitancy to write. I want to write. Yes, get down and just start writing. I think that is very important. That, and once you start doing that, keep the discipline of writing. because in the end, whatever it is, it's just not translating your thought into words, actual words, but it is also a certain discipline, a certain skill or technicality where it becomes, writing has to, it's almost like a skill. So I think the tip would be doing reading and writing regularly. And whatever you want to, I think you start improving automatically. You realize that, because the more you write, the more you realize that where you are going wrong, what you are good at. You know, it's also a journey of your own. It's a sort of a self-discovery as a, yourself as a writer, as a person of society, and what you all you want to say in through your book or poem or whatever.
And so last but not the least, like, could you please tell our, you know, viewers a little bit more about your new book?
As I said, it's about Saraswati. I think she's also one of the most, she's quite, we know about her, but we really don't know anything of her, in the sense she is sort of marginalized. We know more about Parvati and Lakshmi. And I said, I didn't see her only as a goddess. It was the first book I'm writing about a goddess. So essentially, because I don't see her, she's beyond a goddess, you know, she's a thought, she's the entire process of thinking, rationalizing, this whole difference between education, knowledge and wisdom. I think all this is sort of exemplified and sort of personified by her. But I think Saraswati is completely associated with the arts. So I think that it was my personal dedication to her.
So the link to all our books in this description box, and if you are the audio listener of this podcast, you could find the links in the more about section, and the link for her new book will also be added when the book will be out. It will be out in July. Yes, it will be out in July. So keep an eye for that. So thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Yeah, this was lovely talking to you. And yes, please, yeah, do stay at home, stay safe. And
yes, ma'am.
Really, these are hard times, and I think make the most of it. Consider it as a blessing. I think rediscover yourself, rediscover your books, rediscover your hobbies, and I think rediscover your passions. And I think we will. I think at the end of it, we will win, and I think we'll be better people.
थैंक यू मैम. सो बात का तात्पर्य ये है कि अगर पूरी दुनिया लक्ष्य ग्रह बनी हुई है और सारे लोग बाग इसमें धृतराष्ट्र हैं, तो आपको भाई साहब कोई बनने की ज़रूरत नहीं है महाभारत से. आप ही रहिए, कॉज यू डू यू. और हाँ, मतलब संजय ज़रूर रखिए अपने साथ, वो बहुत ज़रूरी है इस दुनिया में. सो थैंक्स अ लॉट गाइस. कैच यू गाइस इन द नेक्स्ट एपिसोड. बाय.